morning's reading comes from Matthew 3, 13 through 17. As Jesus came from Galilee to John at the Jordan to be baptized by him, John would have prevented him, saying, "I need to be baptized by you, and do you come to me?" But Jesus answered him, "Let it be so now, for it is proper for us in this way to fulfill all righteousness." Then John consented. And when Jesus had been baptized, just as he came up from the water, suddenly the heavens were opened to him, and he saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove and alighting on him. And a voice came from heaven and said, "This is my Son, the Beloved, with whom I am well pleased." Word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Come to a text about our friend John the Baptist, when our own John the Baptist could be heard so clearly in the nursery. John the Baptist is always worth paying attention to. So we come to this text today remembering that. Today we return to the Jordan, and we find John right where we left him during Advent, preparing the way. John is there preaching, as you remember, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven has come near." And he's baptizing those who have come from all around to confess their sins and have the waters of forgiveness wash over them. And through the midst of the crowd comes a young man from Galilee, the baptizer's cousin, Jesus. This short Christmas season has taken us through the whirlwind of Jesus' earliest years up to now. And this is the first that we have seen of Jesus since he was a little crying baby. Being born in a manger in Bethlehem, being visited by wise men from the east, being hunted down by the evil King Herod, being packed up and escaping with his parents to Egypt before then winding up in a town called Nazareth in Galilee, from whence he has come this day to be baptized. This story today, this is Jesus' first act of what we call adulting. Some of us call it that. The Jesus we see in this story is a young adult on the cusp. If Jesus were a young adult among us today, this might be where we would see him take a gap year, as he makes the transition from student to teacher, from adolescence to adulthood. We see him making similar moves to the ones that many of us have made in similar seasons of life. He's seeking out a meaningful spiritual experience before spending some time out in the unstructured world to be faced with all of the enticements that life has to offer, all before settling in and launching into the work to which he has been called. Some backpack through Europe. Others go to Burning Man or serve with AmeriCorps, but Jesus went to be baptized by his weird cousin John before going into the wilderness for 40 days and 40 nights to be tempted by the devil. So, to each their own. All four Gospels recount the story of Jesus' baptism. It is a pivotal moment in his life, not because of anything he does, but rather because of the words God speaks over him before he's done any of the things for which we remember him. "This is my Son, the Beloved, with whom I am well Can you imagine if every young person had such a powerful, affirmative welcome into their lives as adults before they had achieved or produced a thing? Can you imagine being affirmed in that way yourself? If you would, allow me a brief moment of self-affirmation before I share a story with you. I am good at a lot of things. I am excellent at parallel parking, even when I'm not driving a Mini Cooper. I am great at identifying and pointing out the grammatical errors of others. I can sew buttons onto things really well. And my handwriting is far above average. But I am a terrible athlete in every way. It started with soccer very early on in the first grade. And I think that the position that I usually played was called fullback. But my most important duty was to get out of the way of the real players if by chance the ball came near me. Otherwise, I mostly kept the clover on the field closely pruned by hand and put myself in charge of checking the quality of the Gatorade. Later, my winter sport became basketball, for which I am still waiting for the appropriate growth spurts to make me a viable candidate for anything other than holding the bench down. But I was that kid in the team pictures who wore a full set of matching sweats, shirt and pants, under my jersey and shorts. Lightly dressed by my mom, who was obviously much more concerned with me getting cold on the way to the gym than she was concerned about me getting too hot on the court, because that was never a danger. As I got older, I got into softball, at which I was a little less awful. I liked to hit the ball, but that phenomenon is almost always closely followed by the public reminder that running is not my forte. I grew up with a pool in my backyard, and I had never learned to dive headfirst or swim underwater without nose plugs. I've taken tennis lessons, I've tried racquetball, I've played in some casual summer volleyball games, I even threw the shot put one spring on the track team. But the fact remains that although I am good at a lot of things, I am a terrible, terrible athlete. Melissa and I just returned from spending the holidays in Oklahoma, and one day, while we were with my parents, we packed up for a little day trip to Tulsa, to Tennessee. And while Melissa and my mom went antiquing, my dad and I went to a drive-in range. And I had never swung a golf club in my life other than a mini golf putter. My dad, on the other hand, since retiring, has made golf his job. If he isn't playing it, he's watching it, and if he isn't watching it, he's thinking about it. He loves golf. And I love my dad. And I was excited about the possibility of loving this thing that he loves so much, but golf is a sport. And my track record with sports is pretty dismal. So we got set up, and Dad handed me an 8-iron, and he showed me the basics of how to swing it. I managed to knock it off the tee a few times, but I was still getting in enough whiffs, like, just missing it altogether, then I'm sure that Dad was wondering if I shouldn't have gone with my mom to be bad at antiquing instead of being bad at this. And a pro that worked at the range came over and gave me a few more tips, things like this, that straight, get your wrist, and that lined up, and I took another shot. Crack! Was the shot heard round the range. And this shot sailed out straight and beautiful, high up into the air, just like I have been doing this my whole life. But I mean, even a broken clock is right twice a day, right? So it could have been an accident. So I teed it up again, and I tried to do everything just the same way that I had. And I swung back, and I brought down that 8-iron again, and crack! Right down the middle, high up in the air. Now, throughout the time that we were there, I still hit a few duds, but a surprising amount of my shots weren't total disasters. My dad's pretty chill He was pretty excited. And I was excited to get to share this thing with him that brings him so much joy. I was glad that my usual athletic deficiencies hadn't prevented us from having this fun day together. So after our time on Rangers Up, Mom and Melissa came back and picked us up, and we're all in the car going to lunch, and Dad very casually turns to my mom and says, "You know, I think that Jessica could be a golfer." And in that moment, it seemed as though all of the missed goals and foul balls and angry coaches screaming at me to hustle and quiet rides home from the field or the gym, all of that faded away. Because my dad thinks I could be a golfer. So since then, I've been shopping for clubs. I've been thinking about what kind of fancy pants I'm going to wear on the course. I read a golf magazine in a weight room the other day. I didn't understand a word of it. But it didn't matter because my dad thinks I could be a golfer. Nick, the non-athlete, the clover-picking, no-hustle whiffmaster. I could be a golfer. But here's the thing. I'm not a golfer. I mean, I could have a future on the pro tour, I guess, but the fact is that I've spent one afternoon at a fairing and I managed to knock off a few good shots that could very well have been the product of the winner's luck. And my dad knows all of that. He knows my track record. He's no dummy. But he loves me. And so, through all these years, as he's walked into fields and into gyms with me, and he's bought equipment and shoes for me, as he stood on the sidelines and he sat in the bleachers, he has over and over and over again held out hope. And in this latest affirmation that I could be a golfer, he holds out this hope again. And that affirmation, that spark of optimism, that proclamation about my potential, is not actually about my golf skills. It's about a love so relentless that the hope it holds never fades. No matter how many double bogeys and mulligans are in my future. Yes, I will live up both of those terms. Regardless of all that, I know that this hope will remain. Affirmation is an incredible thing. And we are wired to be on the lookout for ways to earn affirmation. When you are affirmed for a job well done, when your hard work gets noticed, it's a really great feeling. Who doesn't love to win a trophy? I assume. I'm not familiar with that, but I can imagine it's pretty great. Who doesn't love being acknowledged for doing something impressive? But that kind of affirmation, the kind of word, can be a blessing and a curse. It can be a fine thing, good motivation in our professional lives, something that pushes us to be better. But it can also be a little bit like a drug. If the only affirmations that we ever hear are about a job well done, it can convince us that that's where our worth is found. It can convince us that any love we get is going to be contingent on what we do. When we are affirmed only for what we do, it can help to balance out the way we feel every time we can't outachieve the person at the next cubicle, every time we can't quite keep up with the Joneses. It can temporarily fill these places in our hearts where we doubt ourselves, where we feel less than or where we imagine that we cannot ever actually measure up. But then when we fail, and the affirmations cease, that emptiness quickly returns. But this is not the kind of affirmation that God calls out over Jesus at his baptism. And it is not the kind of affirmation that God calls out over us. This is my beloved son. This is my beloved daughter. This is my beloved child, in whom I am well pleased. These words echo out over Jesus as he stands there at the river, soaking wet with the waters of baptism, like everybody else in that crowd who came to confess and be forgiven and begin again. Jesus stands there with us. In a new day, or a new week, or a new year, before anything has been produced or accomplished, before any shots have been missed or losses tallied. And in Christ, this affirmation that comes from a relentless, ever hopeful love echoes out over us as well. It echoes out over every person with whom we share these pews, over every person with whom we share the roads and space and citizenship within the world. As hard as it can be to believe, this is the kind of love that God has for all of us. Before we have accomplished anything, before we have tried and failed, God's love awaits us to tell us who we are. That we are a beloved child in whom God is well pleased. Before we choose peace or choose violence, before we decide who we want to care for and who we want to ignore, before we get wrapped up in what we can do to earn trophies and praise, and remarkably, unbelievably, even after we have missed the mark and fallen down and failed to produce, God's love holds out hope for us, over and over and over again. In Christ, this is who you are. And this is what it means to be loved and known. God holds out hope for you, and you cannot do anything to shake it. How we live in that hope, how we go from there, that is our opportunity to respond. We have the opportunity each and every day to remind each other of our belovedness. The best performer where you work needs to be reminded that they are a beloved child of God, even if they fall in the rankings. The student who sits beside you in class, who struggles under the pressure put upon them, needs to be reminded that they are a beloved child of God, no matter their grades or achievements. The person in your family who cannot catch a break needs to be reminded that they are a beloved child of God, even when their circumstances make that difficult to believe. And as the church, we are called to be the ones who can be counted on to extend grace to those who fall, to offer comfort to those who struggle, to give help to those who need it most. Because these actions reflect what we believe to be